Welcome to 2 Month Review, the weekly podcast brought to you by Open Letter and 3%, which we take a big book, break it down bit by bit, section by section, analyze it, talk about it, have fun, make some jokes. I am Chad Post from Open Letter Books, joined as always by Brian Wood, author of Joytime Killbox.
Hello, Chad. How you doing?
Well, not great. We had a death in the family, so that is why we were off last week. We were pushing everything back a week for that reason, but you know, better than last week and doing okay. How about you?
My daughter got me sick, so I'm great. Within the first week, it's like, it didn't take long. All right.
Never does. Is it new COVID, I assume? Just got the new COVID?
I wish. No, it's just a cold, so
yeah.
Lame. Yeah, just boring old cold.
Don't even get to have the fun of new COVID.
No, nothing cool like that. So I'm suffering through this terrible book you've got me reading, Mulligan Stew. So yeah.
Yep. So this season, Mulligan Stew by Gilbert Sorrentino. There are some terrible parts in here. I actually, to be fair, this is one of my favorite sections.
Yeah.
Of all of it, yeah. We'll get into it, but the chapter of Love Letters is one of my favorite sections.
It's so bad. I love it.
Straight up. Well, there's lots of questions with it. So for anyone who didn't follow along with the first week, basically Mulligan Stew is about Anthony Lamont, who's trying to write. He's a pretty unsuccessful experimental avant-garde author. He's written, I guess, 4 books, although I think I can only name 3 of them. This would be the 4th. And he is trying to write like a detective novel, metaphysical detective novel that's like, you know, blows open the whole history of detective novels. And he's a shitty writer, and his
it's a postmodernist detective novel because it has epistolatory sections. It's
everything, and which is kind of the point of this. So, like, as this section is a good illustrator of, it is the kind of core conceit of Mulligan Stew is that every type of writing you can imagine will exist in here.
Yeah, it's like, shoehorned in there, and it's all bad.
And it's all pretty bad. And then he's also like writing, he has the characters that are inside his book want to escape. One of them has a journal about their lives stuck inside this crappy work from this crappy author. And then he writes a lot of letters to mainly Sheila, his sister, who is marrying Dermot Trellis, who is a character. Dermot Trellis and Anthony Lamont are both characters from Flann O'Brien's At Swim Two Birds. And in the world of Mulligan Stew, Dermot Trellis is Lamont's like arch nemesis. Even though I don't think Trellis necessarily sees him as an arch nemesis, he sees him as a worthless writer. So one-sided arch nemesis sort of arrangement, which is where it's at. As someone with arch nemesis, I'm down.
One of the things I want to ask you, because I think you probably have more writer friends than I do. I mean, you just have more friends than I do in general, but I feel like you have more writer friends than I do. And Is it as insufferable as like my experience with writers? Is it pretty insufferable because they always want to like talk about what they're working on?
There's some of that. They don't. I feel like I don't ask people that much
it's
anymore.
Not, like it's not as bad as like this Tony character in here, but I feel like obviously you know this is hyperbolic and grotesque, but I don't know. I feel like there's such a kernel of truth to this Tony character. It's like, man, I've met so many of these Tony characters before, and I'm probably the Tony character sometime myself when I just want to like get out. I'm going to send you along this letter that like, I don't want to read your stuff. I'm going to pass you along this essay I wrote when I was a kid and won an award. I don't want to read your stuff.
Yep.
You don't need to know anything about the book. I'm going to send you the chapter. You'll get it on its own. I don't want to read your stuff. I don't want to read your work in progress. I don't care.
I feel like there's a lot of that. There is some of that, but there's a lot of that like when like with like MFA students are just out and trying to like find their footing and you go to like a book reception or book launch or reading and they're there and they're like all that all the time. And also everyone at AWP.
That was me. Yeah, that was me too. Like this book triggers me in so many ways. Like, yep, I write like that sometimes. Oh crap. Yep, I've done that before. Oh crap. Like it's just I just like curl up reading this and like it hurts me that like he's making fun of me in so many ways and like nails it perfectly of like all the ways I'm shitty is like right in this book, and just
it's
guilty,
so
guilty, funny. Guilty.
And this is so good. This is still, we're still scene setting in a way. So like the inside of the plot of his novel, as a bit of background too, and then we can go through certain sections even. I do have a follow-up from last week before we do that though. One of the things that was in last week's section was the list of books and mm-hmm. the Yiddish detective, right? And we joked on the podcast about having ChatGPT write one of those. And so I did. I was gonna post it, but chaos happened and I haven't really been able to do much work or post many things at all. But I did get it, and I can read a couple of them if my Microsoft Word will open. But I did run it through ChatGPT, and it came out absolutely terrible, just as terrible as you would think in every way. But like, not. It's interesting because as a ChatGPT, as an AI language generating network, it's not crafty, obviously, in the way that like his jokes in here are so much craftier. And it's a hard thing to put your finger on as to what the difference is between like a robot writing and a human writing poorly, but there is something there. I also asked it to create a list of titles, like fake titles for me. And it was like, they're so bad. They're not nearly as funny, but they're like kind of funny. And if Word will ever open, I'll read this, but I guess for now, let's just table that because it's not functioning for me. Nothing's really working quite right now. Anyways, in terms of Lamont's novel, Guinea Red is its title at the moment. It is about Ned Beaumont and Halpern, who own a publishing company. And Halpern has apparently killed Ned Beaumont in a cabin in the dark near a lake and is waiting for the police. And the reasons why are at the time mysterious. He doesn't remember. It's going to be like, find out why he killed this person. And in this section that went through today, which I think in the new edition goes up to 148 and I believe starts at 68-ish. Yeah, 67. We get a couple chapters from the book. One that's like the backstory of Halpern, which is hilarious and terrible. And then we get the Burst Love Letters chapter, which sort of frames and explains like what Ned Beaumont's problem is, which is basically that he's having an affair with Daisy Buchanan and she falls in love with them and they're fucking all over the country and all these different places. And then he gets a letter from two mysterious figures who have wonderful names, Corey Coriander and Bertha Delamond. And they are businesswomen from Mexico, supposedly, who are selling nudie photos and then convince Ned to like help them find a place to be able to do their show, which we don't have any details on yet, but they perform some sort of exotic, amazing show that involves clairvoyance and various other things. And so he helps set them up, buys them a place to like perform, and then kind of gets kicked out of their like threesome love fest. So that's kind of the setup. It's like what's going on within the novel. But I don't know, where do you want to start with this one?
Well, before we start that, I know I mentioned it last week, but or 2 weeks ago, but it bears mentioning again. Have you seen or recently watched, I don't know why you would, Adaptation?
No, I mean, I saw it a million years ago when it came out.
The one where Nicolas Cage has a twin brother,
mm-hmm.
and like in one screenwriter, it's a movie about adapting a book into a movie. Yeah. And The Orchid Thief, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And this detective novel reminds me so much of when the idiot brother joins him in screenwriting and starts taking over the project.
Yeah.
How it just devolves into like just lunacy and cliches and terribleness. And like the smarter brother just like keeps giving in because he's floundering. Like, I swear we need to watch that again. And like, I'd be really curious if the Kaufman, the guy that wrote it, if he had Mulligan Stew somewhere in the back of his mind while writing that screenplay, because it does feel like there's And maybe it just could just be like natural cross-pollination where separate ideas, it's, you know,
yeah,
not that original of idea to have your character become alive within the work and hate itself for it. But gosh, it reminds me so much of that.
That's true. That what was I going to say in relation to that? I think that's very interesting. I think that Kaufman too, I never really liked his movies. Like, I didn't like the Being John Malkovich movie, but he's had a weird career where he was like such a big deal with that in particular, and then Adaptation as well. And then he made that movie with puppets fucking. Do you remember that?
Schenectady, New York, well. I think.
There's that one, and then there's the one after that that's like a puppet fucking.
I didn't see the sex puppet ones, but
I haven't either, but I heard someone who went and saw him talk about it, and they're like, it was really funny because he's like really dismissive of people being like, they're like, what do you know, I'm reading into this, you know, what does this symbolize, blah, blah, blah. He's like, it's puppets fucking. Like, that's it.
So, like, just having fun.
But then he wrote a huge, big-ass book called, like, Antland that Rodrigo Freyzan is a big fan of. But I've never read that. I don't. Charlie Kaufman seems like maybe like a more interesting arc to his career than I ever gave him credit for, because I just thought of it as like a cheap metafictional sort of joke author.
Yeah. I think I want to start with what's that?
He did Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind too.
Okay. With Michel Gondry, something like that.
Yeah, and it's a stop. The Animalisa is a stop motion thing. I think that's the one I'm thinking of. I don't know. Anyways, someone else can correct it. I don't. Whatever. Anyways,
I thought it'd be fun. A really fun one to start with could be on page in the MS Paint version. on page 88, Halperin's journal. It says, "It is quite clear now that not only is Lamont a very bad writer, he has no clear idea of what he is doing in this book."
Exactly. Right. Underline.
And then we go, you said you didn't remember the books. Here are the books. Baltimore Chop.
Yep.
Then we get Sometimes Awkward, Always But Now. Anthony Lamont's first novel, Baltimore Chop, deals with what the author is pleased to call, in a dust jacketed quote, reality, of course.
Three deuces is the one I kept.
I love the Rayon Violet. The title is never explained.
Yeah, this is like, these are like Halperin stuck in the book finds a series of reviews of Anthony Lamont's other books, and then it's annotated with apparently Lamont's comments, but the comments are nonsense.
Yeah, I mean, they're just like somebody drunk and pissed off. Fretwork, and then so now Guinea Red is going to be what, the fifth work. Yeah.
All right.
So somehow he keeps publishing. It's all bad, and it somehow still has work. So
I like the places that that review it too, like Los Dulces Weekly, Near Ear, Bella Bella, Tux, Laredo Lasso.
Flint at the YMCA, there you feel free.
King's Think.
Because I couldn't figure out what why did the song YMCA by Village People show up right there?
Oh no.
Young man, there's no need to feel down. Or like, is it Bella Bella at the YMCA?
Oh yeah.
Like, I couldn't figure out.
Oh my god, you're right. That's why. All right. And it's like, this one gets into like a little bit of the more like on PC joke parts
too. Oh yeah, lots of them for sure.
Lots of them. Like Sorrentino never shied away from having his characters say things that are unacceptable in today's society. There's also like the interesting part that's noteworthy for what's going to happen in the future, setting it up on that same beginning of Halperin's journal, where he says, apparently by his use. Okay, so in brief, Lamont has made a great mistake. Inadvertently, to be sure, but a mistake nonetheless. Apparently, by his use of what I understand is called the flashback, the esteemed author has rent the time-space continuum, thereby allowing us a modicum of freedom. To be macabre for a moment, he has, as it were, brought Ned back from the dead and set him walking around about and talking in the past, which somehow has become the novel's present. I don't understand how this all works. That it is now possible to walk away from the summer cottage and it's in Median and Byron's. So they're starting to explore outside of the cottage, which will be future, is a future setup. But is that the only, that's the only section we get today of like the, of their journals, right?
Yeah, just that little bit.
Just that little bit. The rest of it is like Lamont's writing to Sheila, first of all, and then back to that professor, right?
Yeah.
Who does he say?
I absolutely love when Anthony gets to write letters, because it's the setup for a joke, right?
Yeah.
And the punchline is the novel that he's actually working on. And so it's like, hey, I'm going to send you this thing. I'm really trying to work out the dichotomy of, you know, it goes into his like lofty, this is so important. And then you read, it's just a pile of hot shit. Which is like, it's just...
the thing I love too is like, he's got his letters and his letters are like clearly like, he thinks so highly of himself and what he's doing and like, so on and so forth.
Expectations, reality.
and like every time that he sends like an example, like Omara, where is the short story that he sends the professor.
Holy cow, that was brutal to read.
He's so bad. Like, and it's so
hard to get through that.
It was impossible. And I was thinking about it a lot when I was reading it, because it is supposed to be, like, he describes it as being, like, only the nouns that describe a person. So it's just, like, a list of all the things that identify or describe a person without any, like, other extraneous bits. It's just a list. And that's who this guy is. However, because it's a like there, and Sorrentino uses lists all the time, like all those like list of the books that he invented. There's that list in here of like the rejection letters from the publisher,
yeah, the 50,
which are amazing. But then this list of the characteristics of this Omara doesn't work at all. And a lot of it is that there's just zero context. So none of the things have a referent to them, and therefore like don't. Like it's like the opposite of how a list would function, because it doesn't like a list should remind you of things, should call something to mind, should like be like you know, like something that triggers or like inspires or has like a thought to you. And instead, like this is just like complete and utter ridiculousness. Like just any section, he may have liked many things, but we know for certain only that he liked a sweet summer breeze, stars shining softly above, memories made of this, his mother's rosary and her posary. An old-fashioned melody, broken hearts, baby shoes, a garden of love made for two, moments passing into hours, pretty hubba hubba babies, the roses of Picardy, the moment when the hand started playing, a little home for two, gleaming candlelight. It goes on and on and on, beautiful Ohio, but then becomes more and more insane, where it says, like, you'd best believe he went gaga bananas when he considered the river of Golden's creams, when his heart grew tipsy in him, happy feet that there did stuff, confessing at OLBE, the kiss waltz, moonlight on the Colorado, his ideal, something to remember her by, eight little letters. Like it's just devolves into like such minutia and like interior references that for anyone trying to read it, it's gibberish. It's absolute gibberish. Yeah. But to write it, like, wow. 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 Like, I can't imagine like what it would take.
Yeah. It's just like forced avant-garde, influenced by beatniks, and like it's just this like cringy experimentalism at best, right?
Yep. It's so
vitriolic. Delirium shook his frame upon being reminded of one little candle in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, Thumbelina of the foul fingers, April in Portugal, the doggy in the window, see Hamburg Entertainment and just another polka. Watching the night go by, like, oh my god.
Yeah, it's wild. It's so intense. So you have that as like one example of like the type of writing in here. And then there is the like you mentioned above or earlier, he sends to his sister, I believe. Yeah, to his sister. He's like, look what I found. It's an essay that I wrote in like as a 10-year-old, maybe. I forget what the age is, but it's like 10, about the war effort and how to help out the war effort by like saving tin cans and newspapers. And he's like, I don't even know why we're saving newspapers, but you know, maybe they stuff bullets full of newspaper pulp. I don't know. And it's like a dumbass essay, but it's like another example of like the type of writing that in elementary school, here's your 5-part essay, here's your thesis, your examples, and your conclusion. Like it's that thing. And it's just another example. And he sort of, And Sorrentino like undercuts it by making it like very ridiculous. Like it would be the typical like, you know, elementary school thing. Like, what do you do for the war effort? And this guy like takes himself so seriously in such an absurd way that like even at the age of 10, it's nonsense.
Yeah. I thought you'd like too, the echo and the recurring joke that we get with chapter 4, the tragic jester.
Mm-hmm.
So it begins with suspended as if time itself were suspended, yeah. Like the hand of God, perhaps extended over the incomplete jigsaw puzzle.
Boom, boom. you know, though, what's in, is it in this section? Where is it? In one of the bits that he writes, there is also, in addition to the jigsaw puzzle, is also a few pages later. My life seemed no more than a jumbled puzzle. Yes, a giant jigsaw puzzle swept by the maker onto the floor of life in a bit of fit of unfathomable pique. But there's somewhere in one of these where he starts using the word finger. Like things get fingered over and over and over again. I was like, fuck, is this where you came up with your joke for
No, that's separate.
That's separate. For anyone who doesn't have a context, there's a character that exists in Brian's world, Doug Feldick, who is a wine connoisseur. He's kind of like Anthony Lamott. Like he's a wine connoisseur.
He's very much like Anthony Lamott. I feel like I ripped this book off without even having read it.
Exactly. Like he's a wine connoisseur of the Finger Lakes, yep. and specializes in that and writes mystery novels in which the character, they're called like fingered because they're from the Finger Lakes and he fingers the bad guy, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah.
Totally no double entendres.
Nope. I love too though, like another thing that's like I try to teach young writing students is to remove approximations if you can. Like bad writing always has lots of approximations. And everything we get from Anthony Lamott is suspended as if time itself, like the hand of God extended over the incomplete jigsaw puzzle that men call the so it seemed as we sped. Like everything is as if, almost, but not quite. Like, just say what it is or don't say what it is. I don't need the as ifs or almost or not quite or, oh man, it's such bad writing. It's wonderful.
I found it's in the letter to Sheila, the first letter to Sheila at the very beginning of the section we read, where he's like, yet seemingly light against incredible darkness that fingers them or which they finger, malign. Such darkness too fingers the exhausted and invisible landscape corn. And then down below, the clouds, the fingers are barely visible. It's like such, just he runs these things into the ground and it's so funny. There's within the letters that Ned Beaumont writes too, he goes through like you had the last time it was like, it was said and then yelled and then screamed and then like all the different like options for like tags for dialogue tags. And in this one, he has a running bit where he's like, I lick your garters. I kiss your shoes. It's like all these options of that.
Yeah, it's the same. Yeah, exactly. With the dialogue, like that was a bit I wanted to bring up was every single letter, I think, has a different closing line, right?
Sign up, yeah. So yeah, so
burst love letters.
The in chapter 4 from the book, the tragic jester, that's supposed to be about Halpin and his like life, which is boring and terrible and stupid as shit. But he gets married to someone who has like multiple personalities, mostly men who like basically abuse him and force him out, and he leaves that person. But this is where there's the great list of the phrases that they use in rejection letters, like at the present time. We just don't say our way clear. What we felt, we also thought. Well, we thought, we also felt. Lack of narrative structure, undeveloped character. Like these things I have used before, like 1,000%.
The plot as a plot is very good. The style as style is very good. The writing as writing is very good. And the prose as prose is very good.
Not something for us. Don't think we can take the plunge. Not quite a book. Yeah,
this afraid we'd all take a bath. Oh man,
this is so funny. So yeah, so that's a great section. That section ends with like then Lamont's or Halpin's notebook is like, what the fuck? Like now I'm getting this. Like this is the shit that I have to go through. Like you have got to be kidding me. Poor Ned's like dead on the floor and like ridiculous and is going to have a ridiculous scene coming up. We know, but like, this is my life. Give me a break. So funny. But yeah, so the letters, though. Okay, so then I don't know if there's any other. There's one section of Roche, but it's like got that short story that we talked about. The couple letters to Sheila, she's getting married to Dermot. That's like, they're kind of, again, like, oh, what are you doing with your work? And will you please read this? And, you know, all the, and sending her like all that stuff too. And then we get the, that chapter four, but then chapter five is really the meat of this section where yeah. It is the, both like plot wise explains like what's going on with Ned Beaumont. But then beyond that, it also is like the longest bit that we read. And I find this just to be absolutely amazing. And one reason I find it absolutely amazing is that he starts getting to the first parts are all these letters to Daisy and from Daisy. I kiss your tongue, your mad lover, con una braza, like all like you're right. Every one of them ends differently. And then he starts getting the letters from Corey Coriander and Bertha Delamond. And they're, this is right. Like yours is like our, this edition is, if anyone's reading this is like, there's a lot of typos. Like, no. I had to go through that like word for word, make sure everything's misspelled the way it's misspelled intentionally, which correct. Word does not want to allow you to do.
Yeah, it's hard to misspell stuff like that.
It's hard to misspell and it misuses words all the time. And things are like mm-hmm. clearly like as if English is like a second or third or non-language and it's just like jumbled mess. But it's so fucking funny to me. Like their bits and their sort of like seduction of him is very funny.
Well, it hits home so perfectly even today with when you think of like emails you get and phishing scams and, you know, where it's just clearly like the sentence structures are all wonky and you're like, yeah, this is from Senegal or something. I'm not going to get you.
I used to reply to a lot of them because it's sort of fun. And it's usually on Friday, like sometime today, I'll probably get another one that's like, hi, your car is parked in front of house mine. And you're like, wait, what? And then they're like, pick me up at JFK Airport. I am young girl, Hawaii, looking for love.
Man. Oh, man.
So good. But yeah, so they come to New York. He sets them up. They come to New York and then like they fuck, basically.
I love there's like this. It happens in books like and stuff today as well. But there's like this. Like brooding masculinity that's in the writing where it's like, I don't know. It's like someone's power fantasy and they write it into the character, right? Where no one, you know, if they're heterosexual, it's like they can get any woman they want and nobody can resist them. And there's like,
yeah.
Like there's one, I thought it was like a joke and it was actually real. I was watching some TV show, it's a series, it was Jack Reacher or something like that.
Yeah.
Where like, it's just like some character that's good at everything and like every woman wants to bang them. And like, that's basically, it's like, who writes these characters? Like, what is this?
Yeah.
You know, you're gonna burn that gnocchi if you don't put the thing down to medium low and you want to incorporate the milk slowly so it doesn't scald. Oh, you know everything, Jack. That's a 9mm. It's got a muzzle velocity of 900 feet per second. It could. Oh, Jack, you're the best. Like this person knows everything, does everything great, and then just like everything wants to have sex with them. Like, yep. And that's what these letters reminded me of. Is like this male power fantasy. Or so. It's so funny.
It's really, really funny.
Oh, you're crazy, Daisy. Just crazy for you, Ned. Oh, I'm still sore from our week together, Ned. You're.
Because the description of him always I don't know why I don't know how much of a description there is of Ned, but I envision him being like a pretty fat like pudgy like pasty publishing dude like just like doesn't his suit doesn't quite match sort of jibe like just like a fuck up. And she does say something like, I miss your big barrel chest and your matty hair on your head. It's like, this sounds gross. Like, this sounds gross. But Madam, yeah, Coriander and Corey Coriander and Bertha Delamont are going to be big, big players going forward, too, obviously, because they have essentially taken all of his money and all of the press's money to run their show, their act. And he's set them up with that.
Satisfecton Guaranteed.
They're like, I love when they're selling their
in all capitals.
They're like, you are a leading man of business in all caps. As a leading man of business, all caps, you should get the He-Man all caps set of photos. And the descriptions of the photos
they,
are like,
they are available only from us and exclusive. Satisfaction guaranteed.
So yeah, everything. So all that stuff is so misspelled. Guaranteed is misspelled. Everything's like off.
Items in obtainable in any other parts at whatever price you can pay. Like, that's such a great line. That's so hard to do.
It's impossible. I can't. I mean,
he nailed it.
Genius. It's genius. Even like the part that we chose as the title for this episode is in the middle of that first ad where it's like, just released the ultimate in bizarre beauty, nudes and leather, high heels, corsets, etc. Yes, men's fantastically proportioned blondes, brunettes, and redheads, and exotic costumes of shining misspelled leather, gleaming sateen, form-fitting rubber, vice-constricting corsets, spike-heeled shoes, and high boots, and more. This is like reading one of those ads, like a spam ad, 100%. What's interesting with that too, though, is that there's three things I want to mention. One is that this ad that's in here for the porn stuff is not is like influenced in Lamont's life by the one that he gets that's for the woman that's the clairvoyant at the beginning of this section. That's like, I can help save your life, Mrs. Ashby. And it's like the religious woman, God's holy healer and prophetess of the dark and mysterious future and well-known ESP guarantees, also misspelled, to remove suffering, bad luck, and evil spirits from out of your body. And so like the weirdness of this that he receives of like, you know, you've heard it, you've read it, now you can, you know, meet this prophet, heiress, blah, 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 is then transformed into the Bertha and Corey letters, which are misspelled in a similar way and also have like that sort of pitching thing. And then the burst love letters notes, those are then paired off with, or the counterpart to those is a letter he writes to Joanne, the woman that he had had a love affair with. I don't know, affair, but like love, they had some sort of thing when he was working on Three Deuces. And clearly, like, I can only imagine from his, like, reading between the lines that he was like working on this shitty book and talking to her about it all the time. And she's like, I'm getting the fuck out of here. And now she's married and he's sending letters through like her friend to get to her, to send her and be like, this season reminds me of you. And that then is put into the love letters section of the book. So like there is that interplay between what is the reality, even within here, the reality of Lamont's life and the fiction that he uses, how he creates, transforms that into fiction. But the other part of burst love letters, I think this gets mentioned later, but is like this sort of epistolary novel that he's conformed here. The setup is that Halpin goes and reads all those letters, which
it's a really shitty frame,
which wouldn't make any sense. Like he wouldn't have those letters.
Well, even this, like at the end of it, right? It says at the end of the of chapter 5, burst love letters. You know, I was done. The pile of letters lay before me on the table, like the gravestones and Valerian's famous whatever. Next paragraph. His shoulders shook, and I glanced out the window at the soaring towers of the iron. Like, whose shoulders are shaking?
Yeah, yeah.
And then it switched to I, right? So yeah. His shoulders shook, and I glanced out. Like, there's even just like this guy has no clue what he's doing writing this book.
No,
it's so bad.
I literally just like, yeah, and it doesn't. It literally logically makes no sense.
Yeah,
that Ned would have kept copies of the letters he wrote to anyone.
That's the other joke that I like that he keeps coming back to is the color blue everywhere all the time in different ways.
Yeah, yeah.
The lengthening shadows of slate blue. He loves blue. He's got to get some sparrows in there or something. Love blue.
This is so good. This, oh god, I don't, I can't wait till there's like one section in particular. I don't think we get to it for a while. Oh, it's not that far off, but wait till you get to Lorna Flambeau.
Okay,
keep that in mind.
What was the bad name that we had in this section? There was one of the names in this is so great. Tab Gizzetti. The story of one Tab Gizzetti, and it goes, yes, that is his name. Trip to Miami Beach. His name was Three Deuces. It's a story of Tab Gizzetti. So good.
What a terrible name. All these, I mean, that references back to like that, the beginning where there are all the rejection letters to Sorrentino for Mulligan Stew, and they're like, he's like, are these people even real? These names sound like they're right out of my fiction. Exactly. Oh, so then we good. Get like these goofy ass names that are throughout. Just so fun. So fun. And it's really fun. I mean, are you enjoying it still? And
oh, it's a blast.
It I love the variation. It is fun to read this, unlike other books that we've read, but in the sense that like each page, each bit is gonna be different. Aside from like that, there's a similarity, there's a consistency of tone in his letters right now, but then in the writing part, aside from it being uniformly bad, it is like all these different modes and possibilities.
Yeah. All right. I have to wrap up, unfortunately. I have to go pick up my daughter from school.
Do you have a favorite line?
I do. I'm curious, like, who the audience for this book is. I feel like he just wrote it out of just sheer pleasure and enjoyment. Because it just, you can tell he's having a lot of fun. And on page 89, I just feel like it's a book just written for writers. Page 89 in the old version. If we should desert this novel, will we ever find employment again? Or will the desertion be construed as proof of our unreliability? Authors can be strange. it's Halpern wondering, like, if can we just leave and not be characters anymore? Will we ever get work again as characters if we're unreliable narrators?
Very true.
I hate having to work with authors.
my favorite is also like in that vein is on the new book, new version, page 98. Is then publishing a business?
that's great.
So good. So yeah, I know you have to go. So everyone, you know, next week we will be back. We'll be doing things on Thursday. We'll go in the new version up to page 196, and then the older version up to page 164. So a little bit shorter section. We'll be back on track. In the meantime, rate and review us. Helps a lot. Send along the information about the podcast, anyone you know who might like it. You can follow us on Twitter, or formerly known as Twitter, on 2-month review. I don't even know. It's just look up 2-month review everywhere. You can find it. That's all cool. And I don't know. Is there anything else you want to plug or endorse or rave about?
Just want to plug Daisy. Poor little Daisy.
Poor little Daisy. Your cherry tart.